Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome here to the Rode Hoed on this evening on behalf of the North Africa and Middle East Department of the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I'm very happy to see so many people here today, although the weather is very nice outside, but you prefer to be here inside to listen to three experts we have invited today for you instead of sitting outside in the sun on a terrace. But that can happen anytime. We also scheduled today's event a day earlier than we initially planned, because tomorrow the World Cup will start. And I know you're very motivated and very interested in the Middle East, but I'm not sure if we could compete with that. And we didn't test it, of course. So tonight's topic, as you see here, the title, Caught in Crossfire, Challenges Faced by Christians in the Middle East Post-Arab Spring. Now we see for some time already that there is a trend of sectarian polarization in the wider Middle East. We've had a Henriette van Linde lecture, actually, on sectarian polarization, specifically on Shia-Sunni tensions last year. But today we focus on another kind of, you could say, sectarian issues. We focus on Christians in the Middle East, and particularly the feeling of being under threat, which Christian communities, or some Christian communities, feel in the Middle East. We see in Syria that Christians are being targeted by Salafi jihadists. Some consider Christians there as sort of a fifth column, puppets of the West. That's the rhetoric that's being used. In Syria, Christians are often also in the media, even in the nuanced or quality media, as they call themselves, portrayed as being supportive of Bashar al-Assad. We will hear tonight whether that is true or untrue, or absolutely untrue, or completely true. We'll hear that from our member of the panel who is from Syria herself. We saw the very tragic event on April 7 this year, where a Dutchman, a Jesuit, who lived for a long time in Syria, brother Frans van der Lucht, was killed. And he was forming a bridge between the different communities in the place where he lived in Syria. In Iraq, we've seen pressure on Christians also since 2003, and more recently, yesterday, I think most of you have read or seen on television what happened in Mosul, where the terrorist group ISIS or ISIL, Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, or Sham as they call it, took over at least part of the city. Of course, everyone is suffering from that, and we sympathize with the Iraqi people and the Iraqi government on that. But tonight we're talking about Christians, so maybe some of the panelists will also address that issue. We see in Egypt, churches have been burned at several occasions, and after President Morsi was forced to step down, some Coptic Christians cheered actually the military takeover. There's a Coptic Pope, Tawadros II, who said that President al-Sisi, so the current new president, is the one who rescued Egypt. Now Michael Hanna, who's today on the panel and who will take the floor in a few minutes, has said in the New York Times, and I hope I quote you correctly, but of course you can correct me, on the 25th of April this year, he argued actually that the Coptic Pope perpetuated an intermingling of religion and politics that in fact hurts the minority. Now we saw a Pew study report. They do lots of surveys in the Arab world, in many different countries, on many different topics. But there was a report on May this year, which said that since 2010, there has been a considerable population change in the Middle East, due mainly to the wars in Iraq and Syria. Many Christians are more likely to leave, according to this report, than other segments of the society. And also we hear voices of Arab Christians who complain, and I think that's also a topic we addressed this evening, who complain about what they call is indifference of the West. Now we'll see whether our panelists agree on that. I think I would like to mention three questions or topics which I find, and I hope the audience will also find, that we get some answers to this evening, which is first, whether Christians are disproportionately victimized by religious violence in comparison with other groups. That is an interesting, I think, point for discussion. The second point is, to what extent does the Christian community or their circumstances differ from other minorities? And the third point, which I just mentioned, is whether the West really is neglecting the Christian communities, whether the West should, Europe, US, other countries in the West, should feel a responsibility towards Christians or not, or treat Christian communities like other communities, and more from a general human rights perspective. And what, if anything, the West should do specifically for Christian communities. Now, all of these questions will be addressed in a much more eloquent way than I could address them or even raise them. First, we'll have Michael Wahid Hanna, who will take the floor. He was a Fulbright scholar at Cairo University. He has a very interesting career because he started as an expert in the legal field, as a lawyer. He has a Juris Doctoris, so he's a doctorate in the legal field from New York University School of Law. He practiced corporate law with a New York law firm between 1999 and 2004. So I think knowing some of the, let's say, financial benefits there, he must be very motivated and also very good to have sort of switched careers. And we're very happy for that, otherwise he wouldn't be in our midst today. He has been a consultant in 2008 for Human Rights Watch in Baghdad, in Iraq, and is currently a senior fellow with the Century Foundation, a prominent think tank in the US. He's an expert on US foreign policy broadly, but specifically on the Middle East and South Asia. He also writes, analyzes, and talks about international security and international law. Now, he's written quite a number of publications. Just to mention one, he was the co-author of a book with the title Preparing for a Strategic Shift on U.S. Policy Towards Egypt. In 2013 it was published, so that's very relevant. Published widely in New York Times, LA Times, well, too many to mention. And Michael Hanna will give us an overview of the important issues that are related to Christian communities in the Middle East. And before I give him the floor, I make my usual comments. I would kindly like to ask all of you to switch off your ringtones, off your telephones, because if I catch anyone with a ringing phone, I will not remove you because I'm walking with something, so it's a bit difficult tonight for me. Otherwise, I would do it. But you will definitely not get the microphone as a punishment during the Q&A if I hear your ringtone. And as I always say, anything that will be said tonight by any of our three speakers does not necessarily reflect the views of the Dutch Foreign Ministry, nor does it necessarily contradict our views. But, of course, I will not tell you which is the case. You can guess. So now, with a warm round of welcoming applause, I would like to invite Michael Hanna to take the floor.
So, thanks for coming tonight. I'm going to try to do this within my allotted time. I'm told I'll be cut off if I go over. If I had to title this presentation tonight, I probably would call it the Arab-Christian conundrum. Instability, political turmoil, and military conflict have plagued the Arab world, and in fact are not new phenomenon. But I do think it is fair to say that while this has had generalized effect, it has often had disproportionate impact on the region's most vulnerable populations, of which we have to say Arab Christians are certainly a part. This vulnerability is due both to the minority status of Christians, something that has become much more accentuated in recent years, and really the shifting terms of citizenship and identity that have become prevalent in the region. And of course, they are minorities because of their numeric status. And this has made them, by definition, somewhat more vulnerable. The rising instability ushered by the Arab uprisings initially contained great promise. I think in thinking back to 2001, most everybody saw this as an optimistic period. And of course, this was a time of actual opening, of real potential and possibility. The failures of much of these uprisings and attempted transitions are the function not simply of fate, but of decision-making and poor decision-making. That moment, of course, not only offered the possibility of great change to the better, these kinds of openings also contained great peril. And I think some of what we've seen as the failure to renegotiate social contracts between rulers and ruled has offered a great deal of misery for, I think, a very fatigued region. The possibility of revisiting and reimagining these issues of equal citizenship seemed to materialize at this time. And this was particularly acute in Egypt. But it also offered something that people had feared for quite some time. And that is the effect of democratic politics in a country and a region in which Islamizing trends had gained great momentum. For many years, the great fear had been what democratic politics would bring in the form most likely of the Muslim Brotherhood. And this is a point, obviously, that Arab autocrats have been quite strategic in wielding with their own populace and with the West. But of course, there was real concern. And so we've seen for Arab Christians over these past several years these very countervailing and conflicting impulses. For many Arab Christians, this has always, in some ways, been a false choice. And of course, this has been a somewhat different view than perhaps what we've seen from the outside. For many Arab Christians, it was assumed that, in fact, democratization was not on offer. And of course, their perception on this is an important one to bear in mind. The perception was that this was a choice between the military nationalism, the Arab nationalism, the autocratic orders of old, the devil that they knew, one that hadn't provided equal citizenship, but also not perhaps quite as bad for Arab Christians as what they believed to also be on offer as the alternative, which was a religious form of authoritarianism. Now, we can quibble with that description of where things stood in 2011, but clearly from the perspective of many Christians, this choice was a false one. And in fact, there was no third way beyond this impasse between a religious form of authoritarianism and a statist nationalist form of authoritarianism. And the lack of this third way, a credible third way, has inhibited, I think, the growth of more open politics and has hindered, really, the engagement of Arab Christian communities in constructive political ways. The old authoritarian order was seen by many as the only bulwark against against religious authoritarianism and further backsliding on issues of citizenship and rights, really, that had seen a degradation over many years. These issues of identity have been quite important to Arab Christians. And I'll step back for a moment and talk a little bit about history. It is no accident that Arab Christians were some of the intellectual leaders of the Arab nationalist movement, influenced by the breakdown of the Ottoman Empire, interactions with European colonialism and nationalism. Arab Christians in the late 1800s, early 1900s, were among the intellectual leaders of trying to conceive of an Arab identity that gave priority to citizenship. This is a complicated endeavor, one that had to deal with the role of Islam, but that often sought support in linguistic solidarity based on the Arabic language. But many of these, many of the hopes that key intellectual leaders, the founder of the Ba'ath Party was a Christian, many of the historians of Arab nationalism were Christians. The prominent Egyptian Weftist leader, Makram Abid, made very early attempts to link Egyptian nationalism to broader currents of Arab nationalism. This entire endeavor of Arab nationalism came to some very unhappy conclusions. And I think there is no way to understand the present moment of Arab politics writ large, but also the status of minority communities and Christians without seeing the utter failure of this experiment in post-colonial Arab authoritarianism, the promise of Arab nationalism, which really, and there's a clear dividing line here in which we can really mark the general historical shift that happens, and that is June 1967. At that moment, the Six-Day War, the crushing defeat to Israel, the loss of territory, really brings a halt to any idea of Arab nationalism as a credible political movement that could inspire and provide promise to the region. And it is post-1967 that we really see the greater turn to Islamism. The rise of Islamist politics, the rise of greater levels of militancy, and it is really a straight line from 1967 to the present in which the public sphere is further Islamized, notions of Islamic law become much more pronounced and in fact are introduced in places like Egypt where they become part of the constitution in the early 1970s. But the backlash to Arab nationalism and its failure ushers in a period of very consistent movement toward Islamization. This is sometimes aided by Arab autocrats who want to both co-opt these movements and use them to buttress their support, but also to fend off the challenge from Islamist political actors. We have the rise of groups like the Muslim Brotherhood, who are long-standing members of Egyptian politics and Egyptian political life, but they gain great momentum throughout this period. We have the rise of militant politics in the form of Hezbollah and Hamas, and of course, there is the Afghan War of the 1980s that gives further momentum to the idea of transnational radical thought. Clearly, these are very inauspicious developments from the perspective of minority communities. Many of these groups, like the Muslim Brotherhood, are ideological, have a core belief in religious supremacism, and essentially a theory of relative rights in which Christians are in effect second-class citizens in their own societies. So we have these, and I would say, you know, it's important to, of course, note that these are generalizable trends in the region, and of course, country-specific conditions. This map here is a reflection of the demographics of the main concentrations of Arab Christians and native inhabitants. I think, as we'll see in this next slide, there is a great movement towards the Gulf, but these are not native populations. And we'll see this when we look at the next slide. I think some of the greatest movement in population numbers are with respect to the Palestinian Christians, a community that has undergone great demographic change, and in Lebanon, where the Maronite and Greek Orthodox communities once commanded a majority of the population and no longer do so. And of course, Iraq. After this, you know, if Christians were 10% of the population of Iraq in 1950, that community might be as little as 1% of the population at this point, affected by clearly the general trends of deprivation in Iraq, but also specifically targeted by militancy in the wake of the ill-fated Iraq War and the rise of militant political and terrorist actors as major players in Iraqi politics and in the setting of a sectarian civil war. If we look at the numbers now, Copts in Egypt, this is a slightly disputed number. We don't have hard figures. There's not been a census taken in many years. The usual conventional wisdom puts the population of Christians in Egypt at about 10%. That number has been perceived to have held steady. We see numbers in the Gulf that are representative of expatriate communities. And then we see some demographic change, as I'd mentioned earlier. If we think about the sustainability of these communities, Egyptian Christians are not going to disappear. They are simply too big a block. They might undergo further demographic change. I think we can be fairly confident that Syria's Christians, while under demographic stress and under potentially much more threatening conditions in future years, are similarly situated. This is not a community that is going to disappear. If we think about those communities that actually might be under threat of disappearing completely from their indigenous surroundings, it would be the Palestinians of the occupied territories that are probably about 1% of the population as opposed to the 10% of the population that they formerly represented, and Iraqi Christians, as I had previously mentioned. Part of the different landscape also has to figure into our conceptions about the role of Arab Christians in each of these societies. If we take Egypt and Syria, for example, sectarianism is a much more deeply rooted problem in Egyptian society. There has grown up, really, since the time of Nasser, a system of de facto discrimination, an underrepresentation of Copts in public and political life and in public institutions. So sectarianism is not a new problem. It has gotten worse over time. It accelerated dramatically in the course of the past 3 years. But this is something of deep standing, something that many Egyptians have sought to deny and have, in recent years, tried to blame on the rise of Islamism. But I think this is something much broader. Syria offers a somewhat different example. This is a minority-led regime in which patronage for Christians and representation in public institutions was treated in much different fashion. The Minister of Defense, who was assassinated in the summer of 2012, 2 years ago almost, was a Christian. This is something that could never have happened in Egypt, and still is something that is simply an impossibility. That being said, we can talk about these generalizable trends and the fears of Arab Christians. And here we can point very clearly to the failure of Islamists. Islamists have failed wholly in convincing minority populations that, in fact, they believe in things beyond simply procedural democracy and majoritarianism. Islamists have failed to convince and give comfort to Christians that they would be equal citizens in any post-authoritarian order. And frankly, I think there is good reason to be suspicious of claims to democratic intent. These are groups with deep-seated ideology, and their ideology to date is not one that includes notions of equal citizenship. Now, there are broad ranges of Islamist actors. The Islamists of Tunisia, which does not have any sizable minority population, but still offer an interesting counterpoint, have taken a much different attitude toward ideas of Islamic law. Sharia is not mentioned in the new Tunisian constitution. The Turkish AK Party, which is not, I think, a formerly Islamist party, but it is the outgrowth of Islamist politics in Turkey, represents something different as well. When Erdogan went to Egypt in September 2012, the Turkish president told them that they needed a secular state. He left many of his Muslim Brotherhood friends aghast. But it is reflective of the ways in which there are different Islamist currents, but there is a generalized fear of what Islamism would mean. And again, I think it is a fair perception based on their own ideological platforms, based on how Islamic law, Sharia, is conceived as forming the basis for jurisprudence and legal and constitutional life. Now, this has produced some, I think, dysfunctional dynamics. If we look at the political behavior of Christians in Egypt and Syria, I think as the two most prominent examples to date, it has meant that we have seen a relapse into the authoritarian bargains of old. I'm close. and at some level, we've gone beyond passive acquiescence to authoritarianism to outward displays of support. And I think this is in a region that has undergone increasing polarization, in which sectarian animus has become a vital part of political life. This is frankly not just ill-advised, I think, on moral and political terms. It is also really quite dangerous. It is feeding a cycle of further polarization. It is feeding radicalized notions of sectarian intent on the part of Islamists, and I think makes Christians a further target in the future. And of course, we have seen rising levels of violence against Christians. I don't think Egypt and Syria are comparable cases. Syria is a raging and spreading sectarian civil war in which probably 150,000 people have been killed. But clearly, there has been intent to target minority communities writ large, so not just Syrian Christians. Christians in Egypt, I would say, have been victims of rising levels of violence as well, and clearly have been targeted based upon their minority status. And this has only gotten worse since the fall of Mubarak. And in many ways, the worst suspicions of Christians about what would be in store if the authoritarianism that they knew was ushered away, many of those fears have been realized. Lastly, let me talk briefly about the West and what it can do. Ernesto had mentioned this as one of the key questions. And I think here that it is both important to note that the role of Christian communities and their ability to live their lives freely. You didn't take your own advice, huh? I think is going to be a key indicator for the vitality of these societies. I think it is fair to say that the status of Arab Christians tells us a great deal about the relative success of these societies in creating pluralistic and sustainable politics and open societies, societies that can assimilate diversity and difference as opposed to stigmatizing or creating further polarization. That being said, I don't think that the West should treat Arab Christians as a fetish. I think this will feed into historical dynamics. There are long memories of colonialism, the ways in which minority communities were used as a launching point for colonial ambitions. And frankly, the things that we should care about in the West are universalizing within these societies. We care about religious freedom because it is a core plank of democratization and equality. But we care about these things with respect to societies writ large, not just Arab Christians. And I think this is a key nuance, and one that is important not just to bear in mind as the right thing to do, but also in terms of how it impacts minority populations themselves. If we privilege minority populations in Arab Christians, we run the risk of stigmatizing them, creating the further perception of Arab Christians as a alien force, a veritable fifth column within these societies. And I think that is dangerous. Lastly, I think Arab Christians themselves and diaspora communities have to be quite careful not to associate themselves with the politics of opportunism and bigotry that have grown up in the West, that have sought to use Arab Christians as part of a broader political agenda that has very little to do with Arab Christianity, but is much more focused on anti-Muslim politics. And I think this is, I think these are negative, obviously, trends that have arisen in the West in recent years. But I think for diaspora communities, it is critically important that opportunism not allow them to be associated with such movements, because I think ultimately these kinds of Faustian bargains or tactical alliances of convenience, and in some cases maybe even ideological conviction, are truly disastrous for the status of Arab Christians in their own societies. I'll stop there.
Thanks very much, Michael, for your very nuanced picture and giving quite a broad, not just broad, but also quite a deep view of Christian communities and all the different nuances that are attached to it. And you also give some advice. I appreciate it. So that's why I was a little bit lenient on you, because we, as an audience, we savored every word that you spoke. But now we go to our next speaker, our panelist, who is, we're very happy and honored that she's with us today, this evening, Ms. Raja Al-Tali. She's a well-known Syrian activist, Christian. She was born in Sidnaya, about 27 kilometers north of Damascus, capital of Syria. She is a PhD candidate of mathematics and geometric analysis. I had to practice on that for a while. It's difficult. At Northeastern University in Boston. Unfortunately, due to the situation in Syria, I understand, she became politically active, although when she was 12 years old, her father was arrested and imprisoned in Syria, and she vowed never to be politically active. But she became politically active a few years back because of the current situation in Syria. Has suspended her studies for the time being, but hopefully when the situation improves, we'll pick it up again. She's the co-founder of the Center for Civil Society and Democracy in Syria, which is a very prominent and interesting organization. It's promoting democracy and also training and mobilizing human rights defenders inside Syria. Raja is the person I would like to have on this panel talking about the Christian community in Syria and wider human rights issues. So very happy that she is here. She's currently residing in Turkey, in Gaziantep, so not too far from the border. And I will ask her a question which you can think about, and then I will introduce the next speaker, which is if you can give us your take on the situation of Christians in Syria, and if you can see and share with us some trends or developments that you see in the overall situation. Then we're also very happy, extremely happy, to have Sharia George sitting there at the left from the audience. He is a political activist. Of course, it doesn't completely describe him, but I think that's a good catchword. He's from Egypt, a graduate from the Faculty of Economic and Political Science of Cairo University. He has an MA in Professional Development from the American University in Cairo. And interesting, he is not only active in the field of human rights in Egypt, but he's also politically active, or has been politically active, still, I think you are. He's a founding member of Misr al-Huria, which is the Egyptian Freedom Party. Did not get overwhelming support from the Egyptian people, but still substantial, maybe. So plays an important role. He has been active for many years, even before demonstrations in Tahrir first started in the pro-democracy movement, so also under the old regime. So we cannot say that he's partial. He's basically been criticizing every leader that has been there in the past, current, and probably future too, unless he himself will get elected. Previously works at CARE, Egypt's governance and civic engagement program. Currently, he is active in the Egyptian Initiative for Personal Rights, which is a very active human rights organization. And he specialized on labor issues, but knows a lot about, because of his personal background, also about the situation of Christians, Coptic Christians there. So my question to you would be, and you can chew on that while Raja gives her answer, and then we have a debate, after that a Q&A, would be what does the newly elected president, with more than 90%, I think he did better even than Bashar al-Assad in Syria, President al-Sisi, what does his election or his position mean for the position of Christians in Egypt? Whether it's beneficial to them, what they think of it, and there might be also differences, of course, among Christians. And there have been high expectations in certain quarters of the Christian community. So please, Raja, I would like to ask you to speak for maybe 5 to 7 minutes, and then we continue.
Thank you so much, Ernesto, for having us here, and thank you, Michael, for the great introduction and the briefing, and thank you all for being here. So in order actually to talk about the challenges that Syrians, Christian, what they are facing in Syria, it's very important to talk about the challenges that Syrians in general is facing. So maybe about the security situation, like many villages, many towns, many cities in Syria are under the threat of barrel bombs, which is thrown by the regime on the Syrian government on different Syrian towns. So many people, including Christian, they have to face this kind of threat. If it's not on daily basis, it's in weekly basis or monthly basis. This is the first threat. The second challenge, we can talk about like arrest, kidnapping, and also torture to death. And here we are talking about like not only the Syrian regime, even though it's on much larger scale than the, especially the extremists. So we are talking about ISIS, Islamic State of Iraq and Levant, and also Jabhat al-Nusra and other armed actors in Syria who are not taking into consideration any kind of international human rights laws into account when they are conducting acts in order to have control in the area. But as Michael said, it's more than 150,000. This is the documented number of people who were killed in Syria. And we are talking about much more who are like killed under, who are killed like, which are not documented. And also, we are talking about millions of refugees and millions of displaced people in Syria. And Christians are one of the part of the community who are under this kind of security threats. So if we want to talk about economic situation in Syria, it's also in a very bad shape. So areas where it's under siege, like UN actually put more than 200 spots in Syria, which is hard to reach. That means they cannot provide any humanitarian aid to Syrians who are living there, and this is included like old homes before the agreement like 2 months ago. But in the same time, the many area, even though it's not ranked as hard to reach area in Syria, they don't have any kind of ways to gain money, so in order to be able to provide like the basics humanitarian needs for themselves and for their children. So the second challenge is the economic situation and the humanitarian aid situation. So if we want to talk about the third challenge, it's human rights and like justice abuses. So we, and here maybe we can talk about freedom of expression and also like religion, the freedom of religion. And this is maybe like it's not even before, not now, like the situation is good, like as Ernesto talked about, like I had like personal experience that my father, who is Christian by birth, he was arrested and tortured, and he was into disappearance in Tadmor prison, which is very like notorious prison in Syria. And it didn't mean that because of the regime, as Michael, which I disagree with, when he said that the regime is shown, he was showing that he is the protector of minorities. It didn't mean he didn't, the regime or Hafez Assad or Bashar al-Assad didn't like take into like a lot of human rights abuses against like minorities, including Christian. But in the same time, it's the case where human rights abuses were taken against anyone who rised up against the dictatorship or against the human rights abuses which is undertaken. So with taking those three dimensions into consideration, like the security situation, the economic situation, and the human rights situation in Syria, we can see that the challenges that Christians are facing as other Syrians are huge, and maybe it's it can be considered even more for Christians sometimes when it's under the extremist control. So, for example, in Raqqa, where ISIS is controlling, there was some taxes put on Christian extra, while on it's not there for other Islams, Islamic people. But in the same time, like we can consider the people who are under ISIS control, the modern Islams are more in danger than even other minorities, especially the minorities including Christian, Alawi, were forced to leave even before like ISIS was in control. So
you say the moderate Muslims are more under threat by extremists, by jihadist Salafis, and so than so, Christians actually.
So that the ISIS and Jabhat al-Nusra consider the modern Islamists can be like kind of competitor on competing for power for them, and but in the same time also like the minorities, Christian and other, were able to leave or sometimes if they have the resources to leave the area they were already left in Raqqa or other places.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your insight into Syria, and we'll come back to a number of the points you mentioned.
Thanks.
So, please, Shire, would you like to give us your view on current situation, yes. Basically also the the governance of President Sisi.
Thanks, and thanks for the opportunity to be here and to talk about the situation of Christians in Egypt. I think to reach an answer to the question of what Sisi holds for Christians, I think we need to see the developments that happened to Egyptian Christians and state reaction to sectarian tension post-2011 to see if there's any change or changing trends that we've seen. And actually, during the SCAF rule, the interim governing body at that time, Supreme Council of Armed Forces, we haven't seen any change of with regards to policies with regards to sectarian tensions. We've seen incidents of the state being resorting to customary solutions to problems rather than enacting rule of law and enforcing rule of law when it comes to use of violence or attacking churches or attacking public institutions. I mean, the reaction has always been, like previously during Mubarak regime, a resort to customary sessions, trying to sort problems by conciliation rather than putting it in front of the of courts and rule of law. We've seen in many incidents during the SCAF also a state bias, whether being inactive or by many occasions being submissive to extremism, like the time where they submitted to the refusal of Islamist fundamentalists to the appointee of a Coptic governor in the governorate of Inna. We also seen an incidence of state violence, and in reaction to this state violence against Coptic Christians, we haven't seen any impartial trials or serious investigation with regards to these incidents. The most popular among those is the incident at Mespiru, and the only three soldiers were military trialed for driving the trucks unintentionally, and there were 11 who were killed, and these three soldiers only took like 2 years of prisons, and that was in front of military trials. So with regards to state reaction, we haven't seen any changes. We have seen a lot of investigations being closed and seized and not to be continued with regards to investigation. The change that happened with the Muslim Brotherhood that actually has been, these issues remained the same, but what's added was a more of a hate speech discourse, a more of a less representation when the question came to the Constituent Assembly and representation of Christians in the Constituent Assembly, shaping a social contract that should represent all Egyptians. And of course, there were the incident of attacking the Coptic Church Cathedral, which meant a lot for Egyptians and was for the first time to find not only an attack on churches, but also suddenly minister policemen are throwing tear gas inside of the cathedral. And this was also something that made people forget about what happened during the SCAF time and now are expecting something different from a new government supported by the military, because I think they've seen much worse discourse and they've seen much more state bias with regards and sectarian discourse by the state during the Brotherhood rule. So far with regards to Sisi and with regards to the interim government taking place both 30th of June, we've seen better representation in Constituent Assembly, we've seen better discourse with regards to emphasis on citizenship rights, but we haven't seen genuine policies yet. We haven't seen any answering to the root causes of why sectarian tensions exist, answering questions with regards to discriminations. Probably the draft of the constitution, the last draft of the constitution that was on the referendum in 2014, witnessed a better bill of rights and freedoms, and also with regards to freedom of religion. It could be a better draft than 2013, but we haven't seen any enactment of laws. We haven't seen yet a unified code for building worship houses. So it's still unclear whether we will only see a better tone, better discourse, more...
Do you expect better discourse? Do you expect improvement in terms of treatment of Christians or other issues? Do you think the intention is there, or...
not? Well, I think there is a lot of expectations among the Christian community in Egypt to these things, but as far as I'm concerned, we haven't been offered the program, we haven't been offered but discourse, so discourse is not an enough guarantee for me to know what's expected to be dealt with regards to sectarian questions, so I think President Sisi decided to be unclear about this issue among many other issues, so I can't give a clear answer about that.
So in terms of treatment of Christians, I mean, you were comparing SCAF basically with the current president or government, but in terms of comparing the presidency of Morsi with the current president, you also don't see that many differences, or it's too early to tell?
Well, I mean, just 3 days in power, yeah. But I mean, in comparison to president, the interim president, Adli Mansour, I can say that there was a different discourse, more representation in Constituent Assembly, more emphasis on citizenship rights, and a constitution that offered better Bill of Rights in comparison to previous drafts. But more than that, to expect from CISA, I mean, this will be fortune-telling, and I don't have an answer to that.
Yeah, because Michael just said that regarding Islamists, well, we shouldn't expect them to be able to convince Christians that they can expect anything good from them, and that we should basically be suspicious towards them. So do you expect now a better situation for Christians in general in Egypt, now that the Islamist, the Muslim Brotherhood president is gone?
Well, I think it's right to focus on discourse. I think since 2012, really, and the presidential election that brought Morsi to power, we saw the rise of anti-sectarian politics in Egypt, which was very strange, very different, very new. Sectarianism has always been something that Egyptians have denied that it even existed. They would say these were local incidents. Egyptians don't do sectarianism. We are somehow, this was seen as an insult to national dignity, and it was a problem that had been denied for many years. With the rise of the Brotherhood and Islamist political actors like the Salafis to their right, we saw emerge from the non-Islamist forces an adoption of anti-sectarian rhetoric and discourse as a means of differentiation. And it has had some effect. I think the real problem for me is that it is overshadowed by the authoritarian relapse to which it is attached, to the dysfunctional and unsustainable politics of the state, to the use of state violence against Muslim Brotherhood supporters. It is becoming, I think, it is overshadowed and undermined by the actions of a repressive state authority. And I think what should be a hopeful moment in terms of perhaps interrogating Islamist politics, looking very closely at sectarian animus, which, as she had mentioned, was something that was being spouted not by opposition members of parliament, like the Muslim Brotherhood were in the Mubarak era, but by leading political figures, leading members of state, by ministers, leading Muslim Brotherhood leaders who indulged in really quite dangerous sectarian rhetoric. So yes, I mean, we've seen this switch. It's unfortunately, I think, tainted by the overall political climate. And of course, at root, Egypt is still a sectarian society. The military is a sectarian institution. Now, there is Christian representation, but it's disproportionately, these are not proportionate numbers. And of course, it's telling that during the SCAF period, there were no Christian SCAF generals. The highest reaches of the security establishment are places to which Christians cannot aspire. To look at these people as the saviors on the sectarian file tells you a little bit about those who came before them, but I think I have pretty circumscribed hopes in terms of what are the real possibilities at the moment.
Mm-hmm. So you see it actually more as a continuing sort of trend or major aspect of the government's plural.
Well, I think
Egypt,
it's a social cultural problem. Yeah. I think it has gotten slightly better. Other things have gotten much worse. But I think on this, things are probably slightly better. There is a tension to this because, again, it is a point of differentiation from Islamists, from the Muslim Brotherhood. But in terms of really inculcating ideas of equality and citizenship, I think Egypt is a very long way away from that. And even to the extent that these shifts have happened to a small degree, I think they're broadly undermined by the authoritarian politics that are now back in vogue.
Raja, maybe coming back to the situation in Syria, I mean, the way you also described, I understand there, I mean, there's not a monolithic Christian bloc, obviously, that thinks the same. And so could you tell us a little bit more about maybe divisions within the Christian community inside Syria? Because the view in the media is often, and you already gave some nuance to it, but the view is often that Christians are Alawites and the Christians are supporting Bashar al-Assad, and then the opposition, we have the Sunni Arabs, et cetera, et cetera. Could you give your view or basically break down that monolithic image a little bit?
Yeah, so I think Christians are, as any other component of the Syrian society, you cannot really say the whole Christian are pro-Assad and or the whole Christian are pro the opposition. I totally agree with Michael when he said that the Islamists, they were not able to give any comfort for Christian, and also, like, if we take ahead, also the opposition, the Syrian opposition, were not able to give comfort for Christian. So they were not able to show the future of Syria, including everyone, until now. And it will take some time, actually. After like more than 40 years of dictatorship in Syria, it will take time for opposition to be more inclusive and more consulted, to like conduct more consultative processes. But in the same time, the regime wasn't able also to show that, like, the regime is the protector of the minority. And if we are talking about media, maybe yes, but in the reality, it's not the case. So we can take examples where, like, Christian villages were under bombing, and also, like, Christian community were also under oppression for a long time. And there are some examples where, like, Christian community were showing more, like, compassion and more values of coexistence with the displaced people who were Sunni in their community and were having like joint action towards like solution in the community, while the intervention by the security forces or the state actors were towards like more division within the society, and also to have more like a conflict between the Christian and the Muslim community.
From a security point of view, isn't the increased activity, or let's say the continuing activity of jihadis inside Syria, pushing this Christian community more towards the side of Bashar al-Assad? I mean, if they have to choose between two evils, what would they?
I'm not sure if I agree with that theory of it's either or. I mean, I know that the media is always trying to show that, like, it's either the regime, the Assad regime, or the, like, extremist, ISIS, or, like, Jabhat al-Nusra. I think it's much more complicated than that, and I will quote, actually, Shahir on when he said that, it's basically, we are asked to give like simple answer to a very complicated question and very complicated situation. Like the situation in Syria is very, like, it's much more complex than to show that like it's two parties which is are involved. There are like the majority of people actually now are silent because they definitely they don't like really support like oppressive regime which like destroyed more than half of the country, even much more maybe, and also like half of the population are either displaced or in refugee. But in the same time, they are afraid from the future. Like there's nothing in the future obvious or shown that like there will be stability or there will be an inclusive society. Mm.
So just for the sake of the discussion, of course, let me push you a little bit more on this point. If the Christian community in all its variety in the Assad-controlled area would rise up against Assad, what would happen? Would you be able to stay in power?
It's a very interesting question. I don't think it's... I don't think the Christian is the only pillar of support that Assad is depending on. Like, Assad is depending on many pillar of support. The majority is the security. So if you told me, if the security forces rise up against Assad, can he stay in power? Then I can definitely tell you no. If we are talking also about like the military as well, we are talking about media. Like he has, Assad regime has like very organized machinery of media which support him. You have also, we shouldn't forget the international actors like Russia, Iran, which is supporting the Assad regime. And it's very important to not think of the Syrian government only as Assad. It's more like toward, we should think about it as the security forces, that in there are something more towards the institution, which is like the corruption and the crimes is taking very deep within those institutions.
I think you would like to respond.
Yeah. I mean, I think what we can say is that Christians and other minorities, Shia, Druze, Alawis, are clearly very underrepresented in the ranks of the rebel movement and the uprising. There are exceptional, we can point to individuals, Michel Kilo, George Sabra, etc. But these are frankly not representative of their communities. Now, I think minority sentiment spans a wide range of views, from simple apathetic, apolitical views to passive support to active support. But what we can say is that minority communities are not a major component of the uprising, and that the sectarian overtones of this conflict have only increased over time and provide a further impediment to Christian and other support for the rebel movement and the uprising now. I think people who were perhaps silently supportive of the opposition, I mean, I know several cases where people have simply have simply withdrawn their support, become either passive or grudgingly supportive of the regime. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's a real tragedy that people feel that they are trapped in this way, because it's a disaster for the country. Mm-hmm. And again, we have a further reinforcement and really, in some cases, a creation of very difficult to erase sectarian lines and sectarian animus that is going to be at play for many years. I think there is no question that if the Assad regime fell, that there would be instances of mass atrocities, particularly targeting Alawis, but I think also targeting other minority communities. And so to see
people... So from that point of view, it would be understandable that...
Well, it is now. I mean, it is now.
Minority community choose, or either sit on the fence or choose the side of Assad.
In some ways, but of course, I mean, I find it hard to imagine anybody actively supporting the Assad regime. I mean, I think as a moral choice, that is simply beyond the pale.
Well, we don't all have high morals like...
Well, no, I mean, I think there are differences between passive acquiescence to active support. I mean, I think those are quite different in moral terms. To see, prominent Christian personalities lending public support to the regime, you know, I think that's something that's very problematic.
Mm-hmm. And would you like to comment?
I can comment in reference to the monolithic Christian community and how it's reflecting this in Egypt, because one of the key things that happened post-revolution, post-2011, is how the monopoly of Christian representation has been broken, because Christian representation has been overly monopolized by the Christian church. And post-revolution, there's a lot of movement, whether I would say like there are the three-way three ways of representation of Coptic Christians. Those who decided to still find the church a source of their representations, others who decided to represent the Christian question as a separate question, standalone question, like many young Coptic groups demonstrating and only focusing on the Coptic question. And I would assume that I try to represent the Coptic question, but under a bigger space, which is the question of citizenship, and believing that this is a question that should not be only the concern of Christians, but the question that should be the concern of all Egyptians. And there's a lot in the democratic movement who sees the question of citizenship and support all marginalized groups who, under the title of citizenship, under the title of equality of opportunity, not the fact that you limited to a patronage right to certain group or another. Because, I mean, it has been the question of Christians throughout the previous regimes has been a question of patronage politics. I mean, we give you your rights in return for support and political support. And actually, if there is any trend of, I can speculate, of next president, it seems that this reinvention of monopoly of representation and reverting back to the Coptic Church seems to be happening, rather than opening up the question on the question of religious freedoms, on the question of citizenship, on the question of equal rights. It seems to be limited still to the question of Coptic issue, standing alone, patronage right in return for political support. And I think this question cannot move forward, and any group should stand under the pretext of citizenship rather than thinking of his own interests alone. And as I'm, and that's why I define myself as Egyptian activist, and honestly, that's how I see myself as an Egyptian activist, concerned by Christians, among other issues on the scene.
How do other Copts in Egypt see that? Do they say you should stand up more for Coptic issues? Or do you try to convince them, and are you successful?
Well, I think I kept been saying this so much, but the feeling of a minority inside the minority, that's what I would say. I think the expectation is more, no, we should be standing on one block. The Coptic representation, Coptic church representation is enough, and we should only look for our own interests. But I think among the young generation, and that's what's more important, there's a lot of shift and there's a lot of debate, and this is at least is put forward in front of many young Christians as a question that requires thinking and thought. And even those groups who first went out and talked about the Coptic question separately are now considering being engaged in democratic movement and thinking about how can we think of citizenship rights more importantly than focusing alone. Because most of those youth were previously inside the church and never used to be part of public space. So that was their first entry to public space. But now they're rethinking of their approaches, and actually they're moving closer to the question of defending citizenship rather than Christian rights. So among, I think, the future with the youth and youth in Egypt is quite about.
Michael already touched upon the issue of the relationship, the dynamics, maybe complicated dynamics, with the West. I mean, some expectations from Christian communities in the Arab world towards the West. And you explained that, of course, there's a colonial history behind it, and Western countries previously being guarantors of the position of Christian minorities in Arab countries. Of course, that whole situation has changed. Also, many Western countries have gone through a process of secularization. Some people even talk about a secular bias, so we should not look at the world through the glasses of, you know, religion and so. What do you think, you know, is there any role for the West to play? We have a lot of attention in the US by certain political parties, also in the Netherlands and in other European countries, Christian parties, some Christian parties and members of parliament or other organizations feel solidarity with Christians in the Middle East. Is that conducive to a solution? Is it helpful or not, or why not?
Well, honestly, I'm more concerned because I think citizenship right would never be guaranteed in any society unless the society confirms and believes in citizenship right and defend it. And you have a strong national civil society that believes in equal rights and equal citizenship. Because even with the West's support and all the rhetoric, I agree that it backfired when it stands alone on Christian issues rather than standing on principles, on human rights, on right of equal citizenship to every
But don't you think it's logical for Christian groups in other countries to show some solidarity and try to stand up for them. I mean, the same happens with Salafis in Egypt and so, you know, I mean, certain groups in Saudi Arabia or other countries will stand up for them. So what's wrong with that?
Well, it's nothing wrong about that. But I mean, when you talk about governments, when you talk about state representation, it has to be around principles and not targeting a certain group. It's supposed to be standing for human rights, supposed to be standing for equal citizenship. That shouldn't be selective when it comes to Christians other than that, because this reinforces a fallacy that's tried to be propagated by those extremists that the Copts are not Egyptians, that they're foreign agents, and that's... No need to defend it.
Raja, to what extent is this a very nice ideal, but not completely realistic in today's polarized world?
I mean, so I'll talk a little bit about the Syrian context, actually. If you, like when you have conflict, that in general, people are very sensitive. So favoritism, it's not a good choice at all, and any kind of intervention from the West or from any, even by Syrians, it should be taken into consideration, do not harm approach. And I agree with Shahir that like it's better to base any kind of intervention on like value principle and on like the value of the work that will be done and the human right and citizenship rather than specific group if it's Christian or any other minority.
Yeah, you have remarkable similar opinions. Let's help Michael as
well,
a different
view. I think it's fair enough for Western governments to look at this issue specifically, because I think, again, it is a key indicator, I think, of progress. I mean, I think if this is a lagging indicator, it tells us something much more important about where these societies are. It can't be that alone. I mean, I think this is an important category of democratic values and human rights, but I also think that, you know, attention can be given to it, but of course it has to be in this broader context. And this is somewhat nuanced, but frankly, we know when things are being politicized for ulterior motives and agendas, and when people are actually raising this for principled reasons. And I take very much the same view that there is a public and private distinction here. It's clear that that I'm not going to have the same expectations of Christian groups, non-governmental Christian groups, who are expressing solidarity to their co-religionists abroad. You know, I think they also have to be mindful of the nature of their engagement, but I also have different expectations for private organizations as opposed to governmental.
So what expectations do you have, in fact?
In terms of private groups,
yeah.
I think it's not unreasonable at all for private Christian groups to be focusing on their Christian co-religionists. Mm-hmm. I think that's a sort of natural form of solidarity. We see very similar things in terms of Muslim Brotherhood groups in Europe, who are advocating very clearly a Muslim Brotherhood line. I mean, so that seems perfectly plausible and reasonable to me. But I think once we raise this to the level of official channels, then I think it can't be that kind of exclusionary approach.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Now, let's see if the audience, which is, of course, also not monolithic and maybe very nuanced, or maybe not, hopefully not too nuanced. We go now to the question and answer session, so we can continue the discussion. I'm sure some of these issues will be raised. I see already some hands going up, but we'll just explain the rules for those who are here for the first time. If you get the chance to get the mic, don't grab it from the hand from one of the ladies here. If you get an opportunity from me, and I will decide who gets the opportunity, no statements, but just short questions, please. And say who you are and what your affiliation is. And I saw a hand going up there, in the back. There, yeah. I have to run a little bit. Yeah, go ahead. And then you can already go to this gentleman. Yeah, please,
yes.
Go ahead.
My name is Khaled Al-Abyad. I'm from the Egyptian Ministry of Foreign Affairs. My question is for Mr. Michael. You talked about the different approaches between Islamic groups in the region. You talked about Egypt, Tunisia, and Turkey. But like, don't you think that it's just like different tactics, but at the same time, they have the same strategy at the end of the day, that is to change the society gradually, step by step, Just maybe the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt were a bit in a hurry. They thought it's suitable for them to take more aggressive steps, while in Tunisia and in Turkey they're taking it a little bit step by step because the society is a little bit different.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, this was rhetorical question, sort of statement, but with a question mark. Good. Okay, the next gentleman over here. Yeah.
Yes, my name is Kees Hulsman from Arab West Support in Egypt.
Could you stand up, please?
Yes. So from Egypt and just coming over for a few days here in the Netherlands. Michael, you mentioned the statistics of different countries. Well, I can't speak about other countries, but I can for Egypt. If you look at the figures of the Pew Foundation, that doesn't match with the figures that you have been giving. And if you say 10% in 1950 for Egypt, possibly close, but since 1950 until today, with Coptic migration being much higher than Muslim migration, with families generally being much smaller in Christian families than Muslim families, and then you have a certain number that is not really known, but there is a number of conversions to Islam, which are all factors that reduced percentage of the Christian population. Now, those percentages are important because if you go to the ministry...
One second, there is a question coming up here, I hope.
Yes,
yeah,
Ministry
okay.
of Interior, SCAF, you mentioned the percentage of Christians in top positions. Yes, if you argue that they are underrepresented, but then you need to have the figures to compare this with. So the figures of Christians in Egypt, where do you get your figures from?
Where do you get your figures from? Okay, that's the question. I got it. I mean, sorry, I didn't study mathematics and analysis like Raja did. Just a simple person. We take one more question from the gentleman over here.
Yep.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yep. Yeah. Hello, I'm Tom Milo. Independent scholar. I have a question that comes up this evening. There is this stunning news about ISIS forces rolling down Iraq and breaking down the borders between Iraq and Syria. Could you give all of the panelists
a brief to one person?
No, all of them.
No, that's
well, that's up to you. But I would be very interested to see what your take is on the recent developments against these backgrounds.
Maybe Raja. Syria, that would be a good one. And then we take one last question in this round. You have more options there, over there.
Thank you. A question for Mr. Hanna. My name is Joe Vorden, Member of Parliament for the Christian Union, one of those Christian parties. I wonder what your advice would be to us, the Dutch Parliament, how to look at Egypt at the moment, because you were saying there's a tendency for the West to support Christians. Well, I see the other side. I see when Morsi was on power, Lady Ashton, the High Representative, went to Egypt and offered 5 billion euros to the Morsi government. At this time, Europe is supporting the opposition council in Syria. So now at the point where Sisi is becoming president, how should we or should we support El-Sisi in his reformations according to the new constitution? How should we support him, or should we support him?
Question to Shahira, I guess.
This was for Hannah and maybe for the last speaker there as well.
Okay, yeah. All right, so we go to the answers now. Michael, you're very popular. Questions on different tactics, and one about the figures.
Yeah, I mean, figures to start out with. If you look at the generalized literature, 10% is the standard figure given. There's not been an official census taken in Egypt in over 100 years, I think, if ever. This is the figure of convenience that is almost universally cited. If you did a Google search, this number would come up over and over and over again. It's a guess. It's an estimate. I've always thought it's a pretty good guess. I could be wrong. Many other people could be wrong. But I don't know. Is it 7%? This is the government figure. But of course, the government has always had that figure has stayed static at a point when that 7% number was not believable. It could be off. I don't know. In terms of needing to know, when I compare zero to whatever the proportion is, I can tell that that's not proportionate, right? So at the top levels of, you know, Boutros Ghali went from being the deputy foreign minister, someone who couldn't be the foreign minister of his own country, but went to being the Secretary General of the United Nations. That tells us something about sort of bureaucratic dynamics of sectarianism. So we can say very confidently that Copts, regardless of what that percentage is, whether it's 5, 7, or 10, are underrepresented at the highest reaches of government as a general rule. In terms of the idea of Islamists as monolithic, essentially, and only differing about tactics, I think this is not true. I think it's wrong. I think the context in which these things happen are not just happenstance. Societies have a very important role in terms of creating expectations and intentions. And it does tell me something, despite the fact of many differences with the Nahda party. The fact that Sharia is not in the constitution is not just a question of tactics. Constitutions are the highest legal order, the framing document of a country and a society. That is much more than tactics. Now, will they try to legislate various kinds of Islamist influence legislation through parliament? I'm sure they will. But I think these are still very serious differences of kind. I don't think the Muslim Brotherhood is monolithic. I don't think we can talk simply about, and this is something the Egyptian government does constantly, but talking about the Muslim Brotherhood and Sayyid Qutb as the sort of the wellspring for Al-Qaeda and all Islamist militancy. I think we have to disaggregate and we have to be clear and precise. We can dispute and disagree with the Muslim Brotherhood about many things. I think we should on moral and political terms. But when we are sloppy in how we talk about things, when we conflate, I think it's analytically dangerous, and I think it's morally dangerous. These groups are not the same. We can disagree with them on a whole range of things. But clearly the AK party in Egypt looks very different than Jabhat al-Nusra, that looks very different than Daesh. I mean, these things are different entities. They have different ideologies. I take their ideologies seriously. I take them at their word. Some of these ideologies are very problematic, but I don't think it's simply tactics. And then lastly, on how to look at Egypt, the present course is not one that can bring stability to the country. I think we have been for far too long with Egypt, whether that is Mubarak, whether that is the SCAF, whether that is the Muslim Brotherhood, and whether in terms of the present, we have been far too willing to engage unconditionally with Egyptian leadership and ruling parties. Egypt has been seen as too big to fail, too important, very critical strategic interests, and I think it hasn't worked out well. I think we have to be conditioning this relationship in important ways. I think the United States is struggling with how best to deal with this. I think going back to the status quo ante is a mistake. The Egyptian regime is throwing foreign journalists in jail. The Ministry of Interior uses undifferentiated violence against protesters. I have several friends that are in jail for simply protesting. This is not a democratizing path. Regardless of our views of the Muslim Brotherhood, it's very difficult to look at the current situation and think that Egypt is on the path to democratization. I don't think Egypt has been on the path to democratization basically at any point since the fall of Mubarak, but I think we can say that as well for the current moment.
Michael, you mentioned something like conditionality, yeah, basically. So what conditions would you put forward now for the current government, and what measures would you advise then to be taken if those conditions are not met?
I mean, I think
to make it very concrete.
The U.S. has tried to bifurcate this in some ways, and now there are different categories of assistance. I mean, one problem for the United States is most of our assistance goes to security. It's mostly military assistance. And I'm not convinced that security assistance is a particularly effective democratizing tool. The core interests at stake are obviously security. And I think what we see now is that the aid has been divided, essentially. So there is an exemption available for the United States now, a certification for aid to go to counterterrorism and border security, very clearly focused on security concerns. And I think that's fairly understandable. if not totally unproblematic. And a democratizing certification is needed for the full amount of aid. I think that is, for the United States at least, probably a sensible solution. I think over the long term we have to restructure our aid. I think we need to move away from the heavy dependence on almost to the exclusion of all other aid of security assistance. But I do think European aid looks different because it's not primarily one of security assistance.
There was the question of the Dutch member of parliament. So you were talking about the U.S., which is obvious because the U.S. has a big stake there in terms of security and giving a large contribution, so maybe has some more leverage. But what could, for example, the Netherlands or European countries do? What should they put conditions forward and what conditions and
I mean,
do what?
The same kinds of security concerns don't play. For Holland, Egypt is not a critical feature of its regional security policy. It's in a different, it's differently situated. So I think there is opportunity there to be selective about how you engage Egypt. I think it's much more effective if European policy can speak in one voice, something it's not doing on Egypt right now. And on basically anything, but it obviously enhances European leverage when that is the case. But to offer inducements if Egypt begins to take credible steps toward democratization, I think that's a fair approach.
That's more carrots than sticks, actually, then.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure what the sticks are going to be at this point, but I think it's fair enough to try. I don't know if there's any other option than to try to engage with Egypt. Egypt is important for a whole variety of reasons. And I think carrots are probably something that might work best.
And can sometimes be used as a stick, too. You know? Very hard carrot. But anyway, we go to Shire. Maybe you could pick up also on this the same point question of...
I think the question is how to evaluate a regime or a political system as in favor of minorities or in favor of citizenship. It should not stop short on discourse. I mean, to say that you're willing to support, I mean, that's the question of the Netherlands government and parliament, but to say that this, will Sisi be in favor of citizenship, will he be in favor of democratic practice, I think this requires more than rhetoric and discourse. It requires more to see what will happen in terms of enactment of laws. Will we continue on customary solutions to sectarian violence? Will we address the root causes of sectarian violence by addressing a unified code for building worship houses? Will we allow that not to reinvent the politics of patronage once again and citizenship rights to be in return for political support? Or will it be an open space where different political groups can be represented? And actually, the last sign of indication that I have on my hands, it's not Sisi's law, but I don't see any prospects of him amending the parliamentary law, but the parliamentary law seems to be enforcing exclusion, seems to be designed for politics for those who have money, not for integration of civil society, not for allowing different groups to be represented in parliament. It seems to be designed for certain forces. These are... Because, again, the root causes of sectarian tension is equality of opportunities, anti-discrimination laws. We do not simply want to have a space for Christians, but we have a very discriminatory laws against Shiites or against Baha'is. Will there be a root cause against sectarianism and equality of opportunity, impartial, blind to race, religion, sex? That's the question. That's where real improvement should be seen against policies and against real enactments of laws,
Of general human rights approach, not singling out certain communities, but then to get in, to become a little bit more specific than, I mean, the question a member of parliament has, but a lot of us have, you know, we're struggling with this idea of conditionality, you know. Do you think any conditions should be put into practice and any measures should be taken or not? I mean, we also have to be modest in terms of what we can achieve.
I don't see it had ever put any leverage on the Egyptian government. And I think if you want to win, you need to win the people. And I think to win the people, you need to offer a credible discourse, a discourse that looks at human rights on an impartial basis. I mean, the minute you look at human rights and being selective on it and whenever it favors your political interest, you don't expect any leverage on... or support by civil society or by Egyptian people, and that's where the leverage is lost. So Sticks, I don't understand what sticks is available, conditionality, I don't know what kind of leverage it can impact unless the Egyptians are not willing to listen to recommendations, to proposals, to solutions, and to listen to an impartial discourse with regards to human rights. Mm-hmm.
So. Okay, thanks very much. I go to Raja, there was a question on ISIS recent.
Yeah, thank you actually for the question, because I think it shouldn't be worrisome only for Syrians or Iraqi. I think like the growth of extremism and the control of ISIS over like part of Iraq or like moving from Syria to Iraq, I think it should be like a big problem for the whole region and also maybe worrying for the whole international community. It's, I mean, in Syria, the rising of extremism, especially like having like foreign actors going inside Syria, like crossing the border and having foreigners coming, I think it was like maybe the starting of the problem with, especially in the northern part of Syria, to cause more trouble, and also in the same time going away from the first call of like freedom, justice, etc., and the value that the uprising started for. So I think like Syrians are seeing this as a big problem, and I think the more extension the extremist group is having, the more the conflict will be extended in Syria, and I think the whole region will be in trouble.
Okay, thanks very much. We go to the second round of questions. You were the first in the second round. Please raise your hand if you want, and the lady with the second lady over here, if you can come with the mic already here into the front, please go ahead.
My name is Fritz Bolkestein. My last job was as member of the European Commission in Brussels. A few arguments have been mentioned tonight opposing the aid from Western Europe to specific Christian communities in the Middle East. First of all, it was thought that if they received such aid, it would increase their profile and thereby they might attract fire from the majority. The second argument mentioned was that it might be seen as a foreign intervention. And therefore, my question is quite simple. Do the Christian communities in the Middle East want aid from Europe, or do they not want such aid?
Okay, clear question. We'll see who will address that. Then we go here to the front. Where are the ladies with the mics? I can't see you. You better stand up, then I can see you. When here, please. Yeah. We come there. Don't worry about it.
I have heard the word democracy repeated many times here. The question is how democracy can work in Muslim countries, where there's a very big community of people who can't be tolerant to the other religions, for instance. How do you plan to make democracy working in such countries?
That's a very broad question. Thank you very much. Then we go to the back lady there. Yeah. And then.
I'm Alida van der Veen. I'm a Dutch citizen, not affiliated. I have a question. Mr. Hanna, you spoke of the grudging acquiescence of Egyptian Christians to the authoritarian regime for the sake of protection being shielded. You also mentioned that they were active in the post-colonial time, in the emancipatory movement, nationalist movement, secular movement. And I wonder, there was the Ba'ath ideology, but there were also socialists and
wait
communists. And my question is...
very interesting what you're saying. But
yes. How far... actually, the fall of Mubarak, the Egyptian revolution, must be contributed not so much or also not only to people demonstrating on Tahrir Square, but all those organizations that have been resisting in a resisting force within Egypt for the last 60 years, and that is socialists, social democrats, communists, university intelligentsia. Okay. What was their part in it, and what is the country effect of social, economical, very powerful families that are maybe a necessity
okay.
for the
much.
Egyptian
to
presidency
to a lot of people want to
for
ask
their power.
Questions, so we'll leave it to this. Sure, I hope you understood the question. Take a glass of water and you will. Yeah. Maybe something stronger. Please.
Thank you very much. My name is Feye Duim. I work with Kerk in Actie, Protestant Church in the Netherlands. And we relate to Christian communities and churches in Syria, both in Syria and in Egypt. And my question is about the discussion among young Christians, but also young Muslims, on the relations between religion and power, religion and state, in relation to the discussions on citizenship. When you speak to Egyptians, they will say, we were subordinates, now we are citizens, and we want our rights. And I get the feeling that there is a movement going on among especially young people to get this debate running. Do you feel the same? Is there a debate going, or is it totally dead?
On citizenship debate, yeah. Okay. Got it? Okay, we'll go to the panel now. We had the first question was on aid from the West, whether it could be counterproductive or not, or what would be the response to that. Basically, very clear question, do Christian communities in the Middle East want aid assistance from the West?
So, I will talk about Syria. I think Syrians in general want help and aid from the West, and this includes Christians.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not a question, no. Do Christian communities? Yes,
I said including yes. Christians.
Yeah, okay. That's not an answer. Well, it is an answer. She said yes, basically. But the others want aid, too. Shahir, would you like to answer that question?
Well, honestly,
in a very clear way.
Yeah. Hopefully. I mean, for me, my answer would be no. I mean, I do not think that citizenship rights will ever be promoted based on Western support or aid of the West. I think citizenship rights shall never be safeguarded, protected, unless we have a strong civil society and citizens claiming for their entitlement for full rights and responsibility.
But I go back to the question, because that's your view, which is well appreciated, but the question is, do Christian communities, so not necessarily yourself, but Christian communities want aid in the West.
I mean,
it's a very broad question.
I mean, if I refuse to talk on, I mean, to believe that the Christian community is not a monolithic, I will not put myself in claim to say I represent all Christians. I wouldn't know if they would want aid.
You don't have to represent, but you know the views of those communities.
There could be who would want aid. There could be who would think that that's a possible way of.
Is that a large group or a small group? Or
again, very hard, very unclear, very dynamic situation in Egypt to give such a firm answer to that. But from my side, it will never be my bet. My bet is on civil society, on Egyptians standing for their own rights.
You don't think it would have a positive effect on that base?
Well, I don't think it will have a strong impact to be concerned with, or if it happens, might be good, but it happens in a very selective way. It has its own negative impacts, as we said. But again, it does not create a solid impact or a bigger impact on Christian rights. I think what creates a true impact is the readiness of Egyptian Christians to claim their rights as full citizens and to strengthen their position with a strong civil society in society.
Now we go to Michael with the same question, but maybe you could broaden it a little bit also beyond the Christian communities in Egypt and Syria.
Well, I mean, Western aid is problematic in the Arab world for a variety of reasons. I think there are divergent views among diaspora groups and groups that are in the countries. I think there is no justifiable case to be made that Western governments should be giving directed aid specifically to minority communities. I think that's a huge mistake. And I think that Christian leaders in these countries understand how problematic that kind of singling out would be. So I would tell you that I don't think that at any, particularly at the leadership level of the churches, they want attention, they want the West to speak out about these issues. But the idea of direct aid going solely to Christians, I think that's a non-starter for Christian groups. They're savvy enough to know what that would do to them on domestically. In terms of some of the other questions, how democracy can work in Muslim countries? It works great in Indonesia. Those people are Muslims. I don't think there's any such thing, frankly, as the Muslim world. I don't think there's any such thing as the Christian world.
Secularism was not inherited by Europe and the West. It was something that was the product of a lot of intellectual thought and time. I don't think that Muslims are somehow culturally resistant to ideas of democracy. I think there are specific historical causes in the latter half of the 20th century having to do with conflict and nationalism, the rise of Islamism, that have made democratization more difficult in the current Arab world. But there's nothing inherent to Muslim societies or Muslim countries, any more so, frankly, than Buddhist countries or Christian countries. Franco's Spain was a dictatorship until the 1970s. That was not very long ago. And at that time, there was an alternative question that used to be asked. Why are Catholic countries in Latin America and Spain and Portugal, why are Catholic countries so resistant to democratization? Is it something about Catholicism itself that is inherently resistant to democracy? So I think this is ahistorical, frankly, kind of shallow, and obviously serves a kind of bigoted political motivation that goes beyond any kind of intellectual inquiry about this. So I think it's a slightly offensive question. When we talk about the young on religion and state, I do think, Shahira maybe can talk to this as well, but I think there are generational differences. I think you see this in Egypt. I think the Coptic Church is not a secular endorsing institution. So this is another, you know, this is a complication here. The church wants to have a vital role in terms of how it relates as an arbiter between the community and the state, particularly on matters of personal status, divorce. The Coptic Church is not wanting to see a civil divorce law, right? It wants to be the one who is the arbiter here. So I think there are differences between church hierarchy as well as others. The church itself is not a secular institution, doesn't believe in secular values across the board. There are generational differences that I think are important and will play out over time.
Maybe Shahir, you could say something about those generational differences, not being too old yourself.
Yes.
And also talk about citizenship, whether there is some movement among young people to basically to focus on citizenship.
No, I think that's one of the major successes of the revolution, which are very few so far. I mean, is this sense of empowerment and revisiting all the old ways of reacting to politics, reacting to public space. And of course, at the heart of that is the young people. Of course, the young people still have the diseases of society, so you will have those who would want to stay with the church, who adores dictatorships, who thinks that we want patronage politics, but you would see that with the younger generation, there are more space for them to revisit and question things. And the movement among the youth is actually expanding and increasing. And actually, that has been one major result of the 2011 demonstration. When youth and Christian youth came out on the streets, they've seen something different. They've seen empowerment. And this empowerment, although with all the defeats, has not been lost yet. I mean, there's still, I think maybe we're tired, maybe we're drained, but I think this sense of empowerment has not been lost. And I think more and more to come, we will see more upcoming youth standing for citizenship, believing that we are not entitled but for citizenship, but not in patronage politics, and accept conditional entitlement to full citizenship rights.
Thank you. We go to the last round of questions. Yeah, social economic question, sort of, kind. I think you already addressed, would you like to say two words about it? Then afterwards you can maybe contact him directly. Now you don't have to repeat it, thank you.
Yeah, no, I mean, okay. In terms of the organizations, Egyptian political life was stunted. I think it's very difficult to look at 2011 and draw connections to the socialist parties of the 60s. Secular politics died in Egypt quite some time ago. Now, there was a whole new generation of political movements that grew up in the 2000s began to push back against autocracy. Maybe the most famous of those was the Kefaya movement. When Mohamed Berada'i came back to Egypt and started his association for National Association for Change, it was another that built upon these. We saw instances of state-sanctioned mass demonstrations and mass mobilizations in support of the Second Intifada and against the Iraq War. These were safety valve kind of exercises on the part of the regime. They let them happen as a way to blow off political steam, but they clearly expanded the imagination of Egyptians and I think got people thinking about the power of public spaces. So all these things came together, I think, in a way, in 2011, but their roots are not found in the social movements of old.
Thanks very much. You gave an excellent answer too. No, we have to deal with that later separately. We go to the last round of questions, and I've been neglecting this block, but maybe that's sort of the silent, well, not majority, I guess, but something silent. Now, if there are no questions there, then we go to the gentleman in the back, right in the middle. If one of the ladies can quickly sprint, test your condition. Yes. Meantime, did I see other hands? I see hands over there. Could you move to that block, please? Go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Arif Letter. I have a question for Michael Wahid Hanna. According to some analysts, the Arabic Spring and the uprisings and war in the Middle East can be explained for big deal by the economic and military shift in power from the West to certain BRIC countries. Is that true? Does it explain a lot? And if so, what does it mean for foreign politics of the European Union and Western countries in general?
Okay, thanks very much. Concise question, exactly the way I like it. We go there. Yeah.
Thank you.
No, you don't have the mic, sorry. It's the gentleman behind.
I finished my MA thesis in international relation and transnational governance. My thesis was on Christian Middle East. Thesis was on Christian Middle East, and I was comparing Christian in Iraq and Christian in Egypt. First of all, I think calling them Arab Christian is insult to them, because Iraqi constitution is calling them Assyrian, Chaldean, Syriacs, and not Arab. And my question is, you say that foreign intervention will make them as a fifth line in the, let's say, Arab society.
Who said that?
Mr. Michael Hanna. Michael.
Okay.
Yeah. But my question is, in 2003, there were 1.5 million Assyrian, Chaldean, Syriac in Iraq. Currently, they are something around 400,000. That means less than one third. Do you think continuing with this policy of not intervening will help them to stay there? Or is the meaning of not intervening let them finish in Middle East? Thank you very much.
Thank you. And we got a gentleman over here. There's a mic and there's a gentleman behind you.
My name is Wimco Estel. I work for Open Doors, an organization working for persecuted Christians worldwide. I have a question for Shahir, for you. What do you think the role for the Muslim Brotherhood can be in the future? Will there be a role for the Muslim Brotherhood, or is it better that they stay forbidden and stay out of sight?
Okay, then you can pass the mic to the gentleman in front of you.
In front, okay.
No, just in front. Yeah.
My name is Ayat Mossad. I am Dutch Coptic citizen. We talk so much about the current situation of the Christians in the Middle East, in Syria and Egypt as well. But I would like to ask about the future of these communities within the next 10 years. Is there any future for this communities? Because of the fact that you assume that they don't want to accept any kind of aid from the Western societies or from Western Christians. Okay, the representative of Syria said, well, there is a possibility to receive such aid, but for the whole community, for the whole country, with the Christian society, with the Christian community. But in my eyes, there is a problem with the distribution of aid.
Yeah, but we have a question. I think we already got a question there.
The question is for me, what do you think about, is there any future for the Christians in the next 10 years? Thanks a lot.
In the wider Middle East?
In the Middle East, yeah.
Okay. Then we go for the last question. Gentleman there, with the blue shirt. The gentleman there, here, yeah.
it's sort of a false start. If you can stand up, please.
Actually, I'm sorry, I forgot the question.
Oh.
But well, I would like to ask Mr. Michael. Oh. Do you think that General Sisi is not the extension of Hosni Mubarak? Thank you.
Okay, well, you managed to come up with that question. Okay, then the gentleman really in the back. Okay, that's really the last question.
Yeah.
So have you responsibility to ask a good question?
Okay. It's a slight change to a question put forward earlier. If the Christians in the Middle East want help from the Western societies or the governments in the West. But my question is, do they need help from the West? Not do they want, but if they need help from the West. Thank you.
Okay. Well, then we go to the panel. We have a specific question in many different variations. No, sorry, no, that's it, because the bar is going to open and we get a very rowdy crowd if people are thirsty. We get revolutions here in the hall. So we go, the first question to Michael was on the Arab Spring. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think this, one, I don't think there's been any great shift to the BRIC countries. I think that's proven largely illusory, particularly on the security military side. And I don't think it had any impact in terms of what happened in the Arab world. I think most of the reasons that for these uprisings exist within these societies. Outside countries cannot create these kinds of broad, organic social movements. They happen because, for a variety of reasons, having to do mostly with the conditions within each of these countries. In terms of Iraqi Christians, yes, some Iraqi Christians consider themselves non-Arabs. We talk about Arab Christians because this is the Arab world and there are Christians within it. It is a term of convenience. Yes, it was a good achievement in the Iraqi constitution that we talk about Kurds. I think it's been a huge failing of the Syrian uprising. We see them struggling with this issue of identity that has alienated the Kurds. I think that's really been a disaster for the uprising. And this kind of Arab chauvinism is a problem. But Assyrian Chaldean Christians are also a very small proportion of the overall population of Christians in the region. So I think we can talk in general terms about Arab Christians. Not intervening in Iraq. Well, I would argue that the decimation of the Iraqi Christian community has its roots in the American intervention in that country. When there were 150,000 American troops in Iraq, they were able to do not much of anything to defend Iraqi Christians. In any event, there's obviously not going to be any kind of American military intervention in Iraq again. So it's a purely theoretical matter. And frankly, I don't think it would do any good. I don't understand how the American military could positively interact with Iraq at this juncture. Is there a future for Christians in the Arab world? Yes. I think clearly specific communities are under very serious threat. I think Christians in the Holy Land might cease to exist. There might be no Christians in Jerusalem and Bethlehem in future years. Due to a series of convergent pressures, Iraqi Christians are under threat. I don't think that's the case for Christians in Jordan or Syria or Egypt or Lebanon. So I think their numbers might decline. I think that's certainly possible. But I think certainly there is a future. And then lastly,
the future in the wider Middle East, but not necessarily in some specific countries.
That's right. And of course, the success of that future and the vitality of their role depends a lot on how politics evolve in these countries, whether they're stable. I think I would note that it's not just Copts who want to leave Egypt, it's all Egyptians, right? I mean, all Egyptians want to leave the country in proportionate numbers because the situation in Egypt is not particularly great.
I think Shire still wants to stay.
Yeah, well, he does, absolutely, and I'm glad he does. Is Sisi Mubarak? No, he's not Mubarak. The country has changed. These are different people. This is not the Mubarak regime. This is a very different regime. It represents different hierarchies of power. It looks to different sources of power. It's dealing with a different society. The fact that they are former military men and leading repressive regimes, I think
doesn't tell us enough to say that these are simply the same thing. This is a very different evolution of power in Egypt.
We go to Shire. Yes, you just confirmed you do want to stay in Egypt.
So far.
And then, of course, you can tell us what do you think. I mean, there's a lot of questions about the future of this, the future of that. Is there a role of the Muslim Brotherhood in future was a question.
Yeah. Well, I also want to talk about the whenever people talk about Arab Spring and how it's a reflection of foreign powers or foreign agents, and that's actually a fallacy, because there's a lot of structural issues and structural inequalities that led to this revolution. And what will sustain this revolution will not guarantee a stability of any political regime if it does not answer and address these issues of structural inequalities and exclusion from political process that led to the revolution in first place, and the weakness of state institutions that had been so drained that it's incapable of performing and acting. So without these structural issues being sorted, I think there's no revolution. So it's not about foreign powers, it's about our structural national issues. With regards to the role of the Muslim Brotherhood, I think that's a question will be decided based on their readiness. I mean, there is a current leadership that had their turns and they're out of politics and they will never be back in politics. They'll never be accepted by society. There was a leadership that incited hate, that used violence, that accepted sectarianism, and they have no chance in politics. Whether their constituencies, whether their wider constituencies will be able to start thinking critically of their leadership, to change their discourse, to apologize for the things they made. This will be up to them, not up to us. I think because the problem with the Muslim Brotherhood is a problem with Egyptian society. It's not a problem with governments, with states. The problem is how they insist on taking a side against the people, inciting hate, being above the people, and thinking they're more superior than everyone. If they changed, I think they will have a role and space in future politics, but definitely not those who had their chair and chance in politics. With regards to the future of Christians, I think it's in the hands of Egyptian Christians. It's in the hands whether they would want to stand for their rights. It's in the hands of other Egyptians who are committed to democracy, freedom of expression, full citizenship. I think at the time being, it seems that everyone is drained, tired, but I think sooner or later, they will pick up themselves. And that's actually where the revolution is struggling. It's struggling because democratic forces are unorganized, are fragmented. Those who started the revolution are being so fragmented and unorganized. The challenge is us to reorganize ourselves, to take time to build our organizational structure and to learn to work strategically and to work and think ahead of time rather than being put under elections designed by others and put in time schedules that we never shared or took part in deciding.
Okay, thanks very much. Then we go for a final word, at least from the panel, to Raja on the questions of, again, is there a future for Christians, but also if you can take the question, do Christians need help?
So I want to comment also about, like, is Muslim countries are able to have democracy?
Michael already answered that question very comprehensively. But please, if you could just spend one or two words, because I have an eye on the clock, so we have to keep it short.
I think it's very important not to characterize Syria as a Muslim country, or I'm not sure about Egypt or not. So this is a very important point, because if we are talking about diverse components of society, it's important to take into consideration that Christian and Alawi and Druze are essential component in the Syrian society. I don't think that Christian will be I can't imagine actually that, like, Syria without Christian as essential component in the Syrian context. But I agree with Shahir, it's all with the hand of the Syrians, mainly, who are working towards, like, coexistence and, like, citizenship, etc. It does. So also, I'm not going to talk about the Middle East or the Arab world in general. Are Christians need help from the Western? I think Syrians in general needs help from the Western countries, and then like by default, Christian need help from the West.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think the answers have been very clear and very nuanced. also very good questions, because that sort of stimulated us and the panel to come with these questions. I've learned a lot. I think they were very insightful. So before giving them a warm round of applause, I first would like to thank the Rode Hoed, this venue, for hosting us. I would also like to thank Marieke Verster, who's sitting up there. Yeah, thank you for applause. And the two ladies, Florien Hollander and Sophie Hollanders, that's a coincidence, for running around with a mic. Thanks very much. And then I have two some small tokens of appreciation for our speakers, guests from far away. Now I have to see which one is this. This, I think, yes, is sort of a cartoon book, nothing sensitive, on Van Gogh for Shahir.
Yeah.
And a warm round of applause, please, for his contribution. Thank you very much. And then we have a book on the Dutch history of New York by Russell Shorto. I hope you don't have it yet.
I don't, no.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
There you go. And a book which I wouldn't mind receiving, but anyway, I give it away. On behalf of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, it's a history of the Netherlands from the 17th century onwards. Thank you very much. Now, we'll have a summer break, and as usual in the Netherlands, it will be a long summer break because everyone goes on holiday for 6 weeks or longer or something. That's the Netherlands. But we're very efficient, of course, in working. And we will organize the next Henriët van Linde lecture in September. We will send you, of course, an invitation. If you're not yet on the list, please inform us. And now something some of you have been looking forward to, and maybe some of you just came specially for that. But anyway, the bar is open, and see you next time. Thank you.